Glory, glory, glory. Good day, good day, good day. Glory, glory, glory. Because of who you are. We don't own any rights to this music. We're using it for worship this morning. Facebook, please do not take us down. Yes, 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 Lord. Because of who you are. Because of who you are. Jehovah Jireh. Usually don't let the music play that long because you don't want to be prolonged with that in the beginning of these worship experiences, but I just had to let that seep into my spirit, seep into the spirit of all of you. Such a classic. That is Martha Minuzzi, Because of Who You Are. I remember listening to that song in the morning before we would go to church with my father all the time, as well as with my mom, but I'm talking all the way back when I was around 9, 10 years old, and it is still a song that I listen to until this day. Such an anointing on her life, and what I didn't know is she is now a pastor. So God bless her, God bless everything that she's doing, because of who you are, Martha Minuzzi. And once again, we do not own any rights to that music. We are just simply using it to worship this morning, but glory, glory, glory. It's been quite some time since I have seen all of you. I hope everything's going well. We are in Women's Month, and we are already 3 months into the year. It seems like it is flying by. I just want to say welcome to the Living Word Sunday Morning Change Experience. We are now on 5 campuses, if you didn't know. We're on Facebook, LinkedIn, YouTube, WPB Media Networks, as well as Amazon Music, Apple Podcast, as well as Google Podcast. So it is really no excuse to not check us out to some degree during and or after our mornings of worship. And if you weren't aware, I am Justin Brown. I am the campus minister here at Living Word Ministries in the beautiful city of Baltimore, Maryland. I want to say good day to everyone. Good day to our founding pastor, who is also my father. That is Apostle David Brown. Good day to Lady Dawn. Good day to my co-laborer in ministry. That is Sierra Brown. I want to also say good day to Living Word's first assistant pastor. That is Pastor Clayton Rory Jr. Good day to also Miss April J. She is the head of the production team at WPB Media, and they control and do everything as far as the editing for our videos. They always come out so cohesive and wonderful. Just want to say God bless you. And yeah, it's just so amazing what you do on a consistent basis. WPBMediaNetworks.com. Just want to say also welcome to all of our Living Word family, our online family, especially our first-time guests all over the world, and everyone who is watching as well as listening to our replays today. What do I want to talk about today? Of course, I have to talk about women in Women's Month. Love, love, love women. But want to talk about, if you want to title this anything, I would title it The Influence of the Woman. You can say that with me in the comments. The Influence of the Woman. I just want to pray, get into the Word, pray once again, thanking God for bringing the Word. And please, please, please stay around after ministering to give you the opportunity to sow seed into this amazing ground of Living Word Ministries. But Father God, we want to come to you this morning. You want to thank you for your presence. You want to thank you for giving us breath and giving us the opportunity to see another day, Father God. Father God, we pray for this word because we know that the influence of women is so powerful. We pray that whatever needs to be said will be said. Those who have ears to hear, give them the anointing to hear, and give me the anointing to give forth the message. I am a willing vessel in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. So the influence of a woman. I want to take you to the book of Genesis. Yes, the very, very beginning, the book of Genesis, which, to be honest, I don't read that much. But the Holy Spirit wanted to lead me there. And I'm going to tell you why. And he led me to a few other places. But this was a bit after God had created everything, pretty much the foundation of all things, and ended up resting on a seventh day. And the Holy Spirit wanted to point this out. Many ask, why did God need to rest? He's God. And these are the same people that will do absolutely nothing all day and will be tired. That's the explanation for you. You have the audacity to question why God rested after creating pretty much the foundation of the universe, but you get tired for no reason. So, well, I want to take you to Genesis chapter 2, verses 7. It says that, then the Lord God formed man of dust from the ground and breathed into him his nostrils, the breath of life. And man became a living being. And then God created all produce, letting Adam know, do not eat specifically from what? The tree of life, or he would die. And then he gave him animals, and Adam named all the animals. But it says in the Bible, it says in the Word, that he didn't find a suitable, what? Helper in any of the animals. So fast forward to verses 21 to 23, it says, so the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man, being Adam. And he slept. Then he took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh at that place. The Lord God fashioned into a woman the rib which he had taken from the man and brought her to the man. The man said, this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of a man. Amen. I love that for some reason. Bones of bones, flesh of flesh. Now we all know how the story proceeds. Unfortunately, with Eve being persuaded by Satan in the form of a serpent to eat from the tree of life, and before not being ashamed of being naked together, they became ashamed. She ended up influencing Adam to eat from the tree of life as well. And, you know, the Holy Spirit, I was trying to figure out how to address woman, our woman of God. And he led me to Genesis, obviously, what we just read. And I also asked the Holy Spirit, so what do you want me to talk about? You want me to talk about the downfall of humanity, pretty much, as a result of the decision that was made by Eve that transitioned into that influence on Adam? And the answer was a bit of both. I'm like, both? How? Holy Spirit elaborated. He said, our woman of God must understand that God has indirectly given woman the power to influence the very fabric of society, because of their natural ability to influence man. as very powerful. I want to take you also to the book of John, chapter 4. And before I get into the actual verse, here Jesus, he had left Judea and he went to Galilee and passed through Samaria and came to the city of Sychar. And this is where Jacob's well was. And Jesus was so tired that he sat at the well, resting a bit. And here came the woman, a very famous woman, the woman at the well. And there was a bit of back and forth between her and Jesus. Jesus asked her to give him some water. She was confused. She's like, why are you talking to me? You are a Jew. And Jews at this time didn't speak to Samaritans. And Jesus then told her, well, I actually have water where you will have to thirst no more, water of life. And she was like, I want some of this water. Are you going to give it to me? Because I don't want to be thirsty any longer. Then Jesus asked her to go and get her husband. Very random. Go and get your husband. She said, I don't have one of those. And then he said, I know you had five, and the one that you are with now is not one of them. He's not your husband. She then replied, I perceive you are a prophet, and Jerusalem is where people should worship. Then Jesus said, there's going to be a day where the true worshipers will seek to worship God, the Father, in spirit and in truth. Trying to figure out where I'm going here. I'm getting there, ladies and gentlemen. I want to take you to the actual word, John chapter 4, verses 25 through 26. It says, the woman said to him, I know that the Messiah is coming, who, and it says in parentheses, I'm reading for the New American Standard Bible, 1995, he who is called Christ. When that one comes, he will declare all things to us. Jesus said to her, I who speak to you am he. And then the disciples came and they were surprised just as her, as far as him speaking to her, but even more so by no one questioned Jesus for speaking to this woman. And a little bit further down, 29 through 30 in John chapter 4, it says, and this is the woman ended up leaving, and she said, come see a man who told me all the things that I've done. This is not the Christ, is it? And they ended up going out to the city and were coming to him. If you look at the word, in nearly all other circumstances where Jesus had performed miracles and put himself in circumstances where people became susceptible to going out and testifying to everyone who he was and or what he was doing, he would pretty much make it very clear to them to not tell anyone. Amen. But here, he did not hold the woman back. He didn't hold her back. Why? Already knowing her influence, right? And even with her still questioning whether Jesus was actually the Messiah, who he was, instead of the individuals that who she influenced, amen, to come out and to see Jesus. They didn't become angry. They didn't want to seize him, which seemingly became a regular circumstance of Jesus. They just came, amen. And we want to fast forward down to verse 39. It says, from that city, many of the Samaritans believed in him because of the word of who? The woman who testified. He told me all things that I have done. What are you getting at, minister? Woman of God, do you understand your influence? Amen. That simply off of your testimony, you can bring out a city. Glory, glory, glory. I want you to say it in the comments. All are women of God. I am bringing out a city. And if you are a man of God, just don't say anything. Or you can say, our women are bringing out a city. And the Holy Spirit also ministered to me a few other things. If you look at society, Western society specifically, where women are free and, you know, and don't want to get into that whole aspect of life, but in Western society specifically, and even in other places alike, specifically in America in the 1960s, there was a marital rate of around 72% of all races, all ethnic groups. Now, fast forward to 2024, it is now around 51. I asked God, you know, how? He said, well, there are many factors, obviously, but one of the main ones is the influence of the woman. And, you know, I was like, how, God? You know, can you explain to me what are you talking about? He said, if women require men to marry them across the board before allowing them to be intimate with them, what do you think would happen, Justin? Marriage would probably rise. He said, absolutely. He said, so why do you believe that chivalry has become less and less of a thing? Because that's all, not all, but you see it a lot on social media, that men are no longer chivalrous and they no longer want to court women. Well, he said, a part of that is social media, unfortunately. But also you have things like OnlyFans that has become normal. You have women who are literally putting their bodies and are willingly giving their bodies and who they are to men who simply seem and or have a certain amount of money. Amen. But will turn around and attempt to require a less financially affluent man to court her. He said they cannot choose both sides. You have to choose where you want to move in this part of your life. And, you know, before it didn't really matter about money. Of course, you need money to survive. You need money for your bills, mortgage, rent, vehicle, your phone, gas and electric. You need money to survive. But before, more up until this point, currently, it was more about loyalty. Amen. It was more about true love and keeping and sustaining a family and really building a foundation for yourself and the next generations to come. But now it's all about, can he, you know, what does he have? What is, you know, what are you going to do for me? And of course, to a degree, you want to take in consideration the things that you are doing for one another. And but that is the main focus, amen, of unfortunately most within this generation. And you have a lot of these rappers, you have a lot of these women influencers who are putting the narrative out there to our young women: independent, I don't need no man. And the devil is a liar, amen. We need each other. Just like going back to what Adam said, this is now bone of my bones, flesh of my flesh, amen. And because of this widespread influence, that is the narrative that, you know, a man needs to become rich, and, you know, that is when he can get a woman. But, you know, a lot of men are saying, you know, why would I even do this if you didn't want to be there while I was building myself? It doesn't really make any sense, as well as vice versa. If a woman, you know, say back in high school or whatever, when she didn't look a certain way and now a man wants to pursue her now that she looks better, quote unquote, 9 times out of 10, that woman is going to say, well, you don't deserve me now because you didn't want to be there through my process of bettering myself. Amen. Many of our young women, they need to be shown and exemplified too that it's okay to be with a man while he grows. Amen. As well as vice versa. The right man. Amen. You know, women, you were created to help. If you don't want to believe that, or if that's not something you want to receive, well, you're basically saying that the Bible holds no truth when it says that a woman is a helpmate. And that even though that Adam had the animals to keep him company, he didn't find a suitable helper. Amen. So God brought him help. Amen. And our job as men is to more so provide, protect, and all of those good things within the process. Amen. I'm going to finish up here. You know, women, you hold so much influence, whether you realize it or not. As a man is supposed to be the leader of the household, your influence on him can completely change his decisions and how things pan out. Amen. How many of our women of God have had a former or current partner and, you know, they constantly are coming to you for your opinion on their ideas, on what they're trying to do with business and different things that they want to accomplish? It happens all the time because that's what you are here for. You're here to help. Amen. Not to say that you're not capable of doing other things, but that is what you are here to do. And going back to the whole influence aspect of this, Dave Chappelle said it best that men have nice cars, not because men like nice cars, but because they know that women like nice cars. If tomorrow, all over social media, women said, I love a man in a Toyota Camry, like that is just so attractive to me, the stock in the sales for Toyota would skyrocket and they would be making the most money in that company they'd ever have. Why? Simply off of the influence of who? A woman. A man tomorrow could say that and be like, I love Toyota, but it wouldn't make a difference. The difference that would be made is if women on a widespread scale would give that opinion. I just want to say this, ending the message, that, you know, woman of God, you need to understand your influence. Amen. Your influence literally drives the very fabric of how society is run for the majority. Amen. With great power comes great responsibility. You have the influence, so you also have to take accountability for what is panning out as a result of your power. Amen. And your influence. And that is my message to you today. The influence of a woman. Glory to God. Glory, 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 glory. Glory, glory. I love that word, the influence of a woman. Do you know how powerful your influence is on society? If you truly look at how society is panning out, a lot of it is because of a woman or a group of women. Amen. I just want to quickly pray and I want to give you all the opportunity to sow into this word. Father God, we want to thank you for the word. We know that everything that has been said was supposed to be said, and those who were supposed to hear heard all of the principles and the things that you wanted to be communicated throughout this word, Father God. Father God, we pray that those who need to hear, the devil will not be able to come in and steal the word, but it will be instilled in them and they'll be able to testify and bring it out and influence others. We thank you for it. We praise you for it because you are more than worthy to be praised for that word and other things in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. So, of course, now we want to give you the opportunity to sow seed into the good ground of Living Word Ministries. When you sow into God's work, the scripture says it will be given back to you, good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, and God promises increase in three specific ways in your life. What are those three ways? Increase will come in the form of things, money, and things that money cannot buy, like peace, a happy home, deliverance for your family and loved ones, and favor in areas where God has promised to cause people to be a blessing to your life. We have five specific ways where you can give into the ministry of Living Word. We have Cash App. You can use the handle, cash symbol, LWM Cathedral, and the number one, Zelle, My Living, Word Giving at gmail.com. We also have tie.ly. All you have to do is type in Living Word Baltimore, follow the prompts. We also have text to give by texting give to 844-859-0749. And we also accept checks and money orders where it is payable to Living Word. And that is P.O. Box 66625 as Baltimore, Maryland 21239. I just want to say thank you all once again for giving me the opportunity to minister to you. The influence of a woman is very powerful in a society. And I just want to say thank you so much for your support. And may God bless you 1,000-fold according to Deuteronomy, that is chapter 1, verse 11, in the mighty name of Jesus. And until next time, God bless you and peace.